Call this meeting to order and invite the students from Jenny Barker Elementary School to the front to lead us with the pledge allegiance. Alright, you guys ready?
Yes.
Alright, you're all in the right places?
Alright.
Alright, here we go. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And the students have a special thing that they do after they do the pledge, so tell us what that is.
We like to share our cheer. We do every day after we wear a pledge for the flag.
Yeah.
Becoming our best children and teachers equals success. Go Bobcats!
Oh, wait.
Doing everybody back or you?
Yeah.
Okay.
There you go.
Alright, ready?
Get us all in there?
I do, ready. 1, 2, 3. Alright, perfect. Thank you.
Good job, guys. I like your cheer. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, yeah. If we could, Karen?
Yes.
Can we have the students come by and shake our hands and then I'll have you have them introduce yourselves?
Okay, sixth grade students.
These students were selected to come tonight.
They didn't come in handy.
Because they were.
Hello, thank you.
These students were selected to be here to represent Jenny Barker tonight for the pledge because these are the 10 students that ran for an office for student council president and vice president, and it made sense to me that since they've shown an interest at an early age of being an elected official, that they come see what elected officials do. So,
well, we're honored to have them there. Thank you.
Congratulations. They all can't be winners. They all didn't, couldn't be president, vice president, but we think they're all good.
Thanks for coming, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Okay. We entertain a motion to approve the agenda, please.
Mr. President, I move that we approve the agenda with the following amendment. Additional certified classified personnel actions for consideration item number 3.
Second?
Second.
Motion by Mark, seconded by Jennifer. All in favor of that motion, raise your hand, please. Opposed, same sign.
Actually, I'm opposing. I don't like the amendments.
You don't like the amendment?
No. There's two in particular amendments. I'm voting. There's a couple of requirements listed there. I'm not accepting.
Because the one thing we didn't have was discussion before the motion.
Okay. So did the motion.
The motion.
You threw me off curve now. Now it's all downhill. Okay, so our building presentation this evening is from Jenny Barker Elementary School. So.
I
Hello, my name is Karen Merle, and I'm the principal at Jenny Barker School. And really quick, before anybody escapes, I would just like the people in the audience to raise your hands if you're here to show support or to present for Jenny Barker tonight. So you can kind of see the level of support.
Everybody here.
Yeah. It's the season of opposites, I guess you could say. There's Naughty and Nice, or Scrooge, or Tiny Tim. And one of the most probably polarizing characters this year, or every Christmas season or holiday season, is the Grinch. And so, being the elementary person that I am, I want you to remember what I have to say to you tonight, or what they have to say to you tonight. So we're framing it with the famous character, Mr. Grinch. And I really hope that my video works. It's not looking good. Well, probably you've all seen The Grinch Who Stole Christmas, and part of, or my favorite part of the movie is when the character realizes that his heart grows by 3 times because of the spirit that he feels, and becomes very spectacular, and the movie says, or the Christmas rhyme says, that he grows powerful enough to be 10 Grinches plus 2. So the premise for our presentation tonight is that our hearts are swelling and that together we are might. So, and the inspiration came from this. I snapped this picture in our gym during our Thanksgiving feast on the 16th of November, and we served 90 plus people in addition to our students that day. So I don't know the numbers everywhere else, but I would challenge anybody per capita to have served almost twice what their, or almost 2 times what their student population was. So we were very full, and I could feel my heart swelling when I took that picture, because it is a community that continues to support and give to our little school, and because of that, we are all better. Really quick, I just wanted to touch with you about our Ames Web data. I have data here from 2013, and we look for trends as a building. We're very proud of our data, but we always want to get better. And just a quick look at that. Because we're small, it's hard to sometimes see trends. But one of the things, every time I look at it, I see something different. And one of the things that stuck out to me, or has stuck out to the staff, was that our winter data, if you look at that column, which is when kids are not off of breaks, or when we have them for a good stint of time, we are showing good solid growth through that. I'll talk a little bit more about that. In addition, here's our math data. A little bit harder to see trends, but we're still not, we're not returning to where we were in the 2013-14 school year. And why I bring this up is because of the opportunities that calendars and perhaps ourselves have provided to have discussions around our data. The kids and I will talk a little bit here about Friday Clubs, PLCs, which is 45 minutes of time on Friday afternoons at 3 o'clock, where the students do something and the teachers meet in the library and talk about our data and what we, and actions that we can take to do that. The other thing that it has allowed is on Friday, our half-day building PLCs, when we are in our buildings. I know we split those between district and building. But for those of you who aren't familiar with how Jenny Barker is set up, we're a one-track school. And so the collaboration time is pretty difficult to get. And so those two instances have created some great time for us to be together and to look how we can improve our instruction to help our students achieve what they want and need. We're beginning to look at our state assessment trends. That's relatively new. We're setting building goals and monitoring our indicators through KISA all during this time. And at this time, I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Horney and his friends, students that he brought with them. Jenny Barker, because of our size, because of several things that kind of just fell into place, we are one-to-one with the exception of kindergarten. We do not have one-to-one iPads in kindergarten, but right now, all of our students have an iPad that they use every day.
All right, well, I'm Matthew Horney. It's a pleasure to be here this evening with my fellow presenters over here. Last time I came and talked to you guys, I was part of the iPad one-to-one pilot program, and it was really fun to have you guys go through a simulation. But today, I have some amazing presenters that are going to talk more about how they use the app. So instead of hearing it firsthand from me, you get to hear it firsthand from our students. All right, Miss Olivia, come on up. This is Olivia Holging. She's in fourth grade.
The first thing is that teachers can add classes like math or reading, and they can grade students' papers faster. And students can use different colors to make things less confusing. And teachers can give instructions by recording their voices or typing. And the final thing is that parents can see students' work.
That's right. So if you look at what she has up here on the board, she has an example of some of the work that she's done. And before, we'd use like whiteboards and Expo markers, and I used to go through a ton of Expo markers, not so much anymore. We use this app called Shelby, and what you can do is put it into grids, and then she can zoom in on her iPad, and she can show her work, and she can color code it. If she wants to put a voice thread in it, or if I want to put a voice thread in it, it's really convenient. It's a good way to modify assignments. So, pretty awesome. Give me a nice slide, please. And then this is an example of the math curriculum that we teach, is Eureka Math. And instead of running off a billion paper copies like we used to, it's now on the Shelby app. And not only do they have a copy of it in color, but they have different tools that they can use. Once again, you have voice threads. They can type on the document. They have multiple different colors and markers that they can use. And it's really simple for myself to grade because I can go through and I have all the assignments on my iPad. And I can flip through it and leave comments with them. So pretty amazing stuff. Thank you, Ms. Olivia. All right, our next presenter's name is Mr. Hudson Holging. He is a third grader. Go ahead, sir.
You can take a picture and post it on Seesaw to show what you have done. You can make folders and add things related to that. Parents can look at students' posts and like them. Teachers have to approve students' posts for other people to see it.
All right, so this particular app helps us deal with digital citizenship. The teacher gets to monitor everything before it gets posted from both students and parents. One thing about the iPads is a lot of people are concerned that the students quit writing on paper. Well, as you can clearly see, we have some writing assignments that's on there that sometimes don't always end up making it home, where they take a picture of it real time, they share it with parents can like it, they can read it. So if by chance the paper copy doesn't make it home, it's uploaded on the Seesaw. So it's a really good way for us to be able to communicate with parents and also share the amazing things that we're doing in class. And also, iPads do not replace pencil and paper. There's still plenty of opportunity for us to do that. Thank you, Mr. Hudson. All right, our next presenter is going to be Mr. Zach Kitch. He's a fourth grader. He was part of the iPad pilot program last year, and he's benefiting from the one-to-one program we have this year.
Nearbot is a fun app that you can go on virtual field trips. My favorite virtual field trip is going on Mars. On Mars, you can look around somewhere on another planet. The nice thing about Nearpod is you can learn fun facts. After you're done, you can take a quiz. I think Nearpod is my favorite app on the iPads.
All right, so that's Mr. Zach Kitch. This particular one is part of the virtual field trip. The students hold their iPads, they move it around, they're able to actually visit different places. It's a panoramic picture. Kids absolutely love it. Next one down on the bottom is actually part of the assignment. They have to point out Mars, and actually what they do is it pops up on the screen. They have to use different markers. They can write on it. If they want to leave a voice thread, they could, depending on what the assignment is. And then they submit it. And then I have 19 fourth graders in my class. I get the responses all sent to my iPad. Once again, it's right there for me to look at and grade. Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Horney, do you use stylus, or do you keep saying markers? Is like your finger? But you
we mainly use our fingers. Okay. There are styluses available for the students, but pretty much the handwriting looks the same with the finger or with the marker. And it's really interesting because, you know, like how you hold a pencil with your fingers gripped like that around it?
Right.
The students actually start to hold their finger as a pencil. It's actually really neat to see.
That's how I
but they do have an option to use a stylus. But when I talk about the different marker options, it's just the different types of tools. So like down here on the bottom, you know, it's kind of hard to see. There's a black, there's a blue, and a green. They would just click on that one, and then they're able to write in that color.
Perfect. Because I just know stylus are hard to keep track of, at least personal experience,
yeah,
so I would assume a school would.
Yeah, but we have 10 fingers to choose from, so they'd be pretty good. Yeah, but what I think is really interesting is when they start writing on the actual programs, when they're zooming in the writing, when you zoom out of it, their handwriting is very, very similar to how they do on paper and pencil. Because, I mean, you still have to have that fine motor skills to be able to write on it. So one of my concerns when I did the pilot was, oh my gosh, how are these people going to be able to really write on the iPads? And I've been really impressed with how the students have done. And they've actually pushed me to become a better writer on iPads as well. You know, it's kind of sad when you have a third grader get on the iPad and start typing, and they're faster on their iPad than they are on my keyboard. So, yeah, they're pushing me to be faster. The next slide is another one from Zex. It also has access to YouTube videos, or it's a different website. So this particular one, it has a great YouTube video about the mission to Mars that they had. And down on the bottom, they have to make a postcard to send it to parents. So if they're at Mars or on Mars, you know, how would they describe the terrain to them? And, you know, it's just really cool. They can also upload pictures and such as that. All right. Thank you. All right. My next presenter is Miss Andy Heckel. She is a third grader.
UPART is an app that allows you to experience virtual reality field trips. You can go to places such as Native American settlements and see a Native American lifestyle in real time. If you go on a virtual field trip, you can see many places that you may not always have access to. Native American settlements are just one of the virtual reality endless places to visit with the UPART app.
Very awesome. So, I mean, we're using it both third and fourth grade. And, you know, even though we're showing these apps from third and fourth graders right now, I mean, we are doing this school-wide, and the teachers are starting to get on board with trying the different apps. So it's really fun and exciting to see the teachers jump into it. Our next presenter is Mr. Derek Hoff. He is also a third grader, and sometimes he ends up with a little extra time in class. So this is our cure for that.
We use Edgy Creations, and Edgy Creations, what you do is you can draw and create stuff. You can also edit it and write videos to and look up and create stuff with the app and see how things went.
Awesome. So if you look at the examples that are on there, that top right-hand one is talking about the number 12. And as the students, they're able to put pictures on there, to copy and paste and put them on there. They're also able to draw with their fingers, not a marker, with their fingers or stylus. And as they're drawing, they're able to record what they're drawing and what they're speaking at the same time. So it's another way to help them become better presenters for different grades down the line. So really great tool to help you to differentiate your class. Our next presenter is Miss Olivia Farmeyer. She is also a third grader.
On Tinker, you can make any skill-appropriate things. And if you get it used to the app, Tinker, it's just as fun as a game, but you still have to be serious for it. And on Geoboard, you can see what two shapes together make. The Slide app is a very fun app because you can challenge your friends. You can also... So, it is also a game that you will have to be quick at solving math problems to win.
Kind of puts a fun twist on it. So she's talking about the apps that you have in the back, and instead of just having the base 10 blocks that, you know, the physical concrete ones that you have, which every classroom has it, you get them out, they have the digital representation of it. Once again, you can take pictures of it. At that particular app, you have the addition and subtraction symbols all in there, so they're showing great place value, and also have it at their access whenever they want. They don't have to go to the cabinet to be able to pull it out. Plus, it's multicolored, choose whatever color they want, the different place values. The geoboard that she was talking about down there on this, instead of having rubber bands fly around my classroom, they stay in the iPad, and I love it. And they can use different colors of it, but they're also able to write on it to talk about the different attributes and items of that. And then the other program that she was talking about was Tinker, and it's part of the coding that was in one of our enrichment classes. Kids absolutely love that. They're very interested in what they can do on computers. So that's what she was talking about with the Tinker.
So another exciting thing that we have at Jenny Barker is our Walk to Interventions or Enrichment Program. And what that has kind of looked different every year that I've been there, not because I want it to or because we want it to, but it just kind of things have evolved that way. Currently, we have kindergarten, first, and second grade, which stand alone, and so that's been kind of cool to see. We have people that flood in to those classrooms to give those kids enrichment or intervention, depending on what they need. And their enrichment at this point just is pushing the literacy so that they can become better readers. So that when they get to grades 3 through 6, perhaps our goal would be that we would not have to have any intervention and we could have all enrichment so that we can do things like this.
All right, so we have a robotics team at Jenny Barker, and we are working with Charles Stones and Sarah Drabinski. She has a robotics team over there. And this upcoming Saturday, we're having a robotics competition. And the students that are involved in that have gone through, and they've done research on underwater rovers. And in the classroom, they've learned how to solder. They've learned about wiring diagrams and schematics. I mean, it's really focused towards the STEM standards. Science, technology, engineering, mathematics. And we're trying to get more students involved with that. What I really enjoy seeing, though, is how many girls are getting involved with it. I mean, I've really had some leaders that have stepped up in that classroom to start showing some of the boys how to do some of that soldering. I think pretty neat. And there's some examples of some of the stuff they're doing. So if you look over here, I have, you know, a student. I show them how to do it, but then I have a leader in the student the group that steps up, and they make sure that people are using stuff correctly. So in that particular picture, you got some drilling going on. They had some PVC pipes that they had to cut, measure. You know, of course, you know, they have supervision right over them, making sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. But it's been pretty neat.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, that's fine. And if you look, I mean, when they start to solder, you have one person pretty much soldering at the time, but look how many coaches that one student has. And I tell you what, the first time they start soldering, those hands are they're kind of shaky, but then when they get used to having the coaching there and helping them out and know that they have support, they do a pretty good job of that. It's been pretty empowering. Just some neat designs, so make sure if you guys have some time open up on Saturday, you need to head on over to the YMCA at noon and we'll support our school.
So Friday clubs, and I apologize, that's I had a parent who was leading Friday clubs that was willing to come and talk to you, but they've had a family emergency and weren't able to make it tonight. But Friday clubs has been an answer for kids who maybe don't get to do the enrichments every day. And an answer to the fact that our teachers don't have PLC time every week. And so, thankfully, with the work of paraprofessionals in our building or long-term substitutes, and then our parents, we are able to hold Friday clubs, which means every Friday that school is in session for a full day, we are meeting at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. The teachers meet in the library, and the students, I think we have about 13 clubs going on right now, which is about 10 to 11 students each, so it's a small group. And they go work in various rooms. I actually ran out of space for people to work. That's a bigger problem than even finding people to come help me, is that I don't have enough places to put clubs. But this go-round, topics have ranged anywhere from coding, so the kids are learning how to make a game or code a game on the iPads through Tinker, to woodworking. The students made pencil boxes, and then they made birdhouses, you can see there. We have cooking, science club, so all kinds of things. They're intermixed with grades, so the big kids are helping the little kids. But I think it's been a pretty exciting thing for us. One of the most passionate things that kind of came out of it was that we created a monster and that there's not a lot of funding to support our clubs. So PTO has graciously offered to help us, but in doing that we had to kind of wade through how we were going to fund that, how much, what does that look like for this next cycle. And when people outside of your building go to bat for your kids and say, this is something that these kids need on Friday afternoons, it's just, it's cool. So Friday Bobcat Families, Miss Jackson. Mrs. Jackson is here to talk a little bit about Friday Bobcat Families and what that's meant to our staff and our students.
Hi, I teach first grade, and on our shortened Fridays, or the day of the month that we have our shortened days, we have a Bobcat Family Lunch. And what we do during that time is we have our students divided up into 14 different groups, with both teachers and support staff, and we meet, and they're divided between, there's kindergarten through sixth grade, all mixed up into groups, 8 to 10 kids per group, and we get together, and we have our, of course, our SAC lunch, and we also talk about the six pillars of education, characters. December's character is fairness, so we talk about what that entails. A lot of times we can find a short little video off of YouTube or somewhere that can help explain those. Also, it is, I think, has made some of the kids feel more comfortable with other teachers in the buildings that they don't have all the time. And I have heard kids talk about, well, I got to go to Mrs. Ford's class, or I got to go somewhere else, and they're real excited to intermingle with the other children. And it's fun to watch how the older kids really take the younger kids under their wings. If they are having sack lunch and they can't get their chips open or whatever, the big kids just jump right in and help them, and it's really been a fun way for us to get together on those shortened Friday, or it's not always a Friday, but those shortened days. I think everybody's enjoying that.
Another great support system for us is our PTO, and I have asked Caballero to come share a little bit about what PTO at Jenny Barker has done, because probably one of the most eye-opening things as a principal was when you kind of turn things over to people and they make it bigger and better than what you ever dreamed it could be, and that's what this group has essentially done over and over and over again. So.
Hi, I'm Ann Caballero, and I've been doing PTO, I guess the PTO president, for the last 2 years, and we've been able to do some great things. We have incredible parents who give a lot of support, and it makes PTO really easy for us. So when I started doing it, I guess I kind of thought about, what am I trying to do? What are our goals? And the first thing I wanted to accomplish was I wanted to be able to raise the funds and to provide the support for the school that they needed. And so one example of that is we were able last year to do the walking track. I'm sure a lot of you remember that. And we had a great parent who was able to get some grants, and we had some fundraising, and we were able to get a walking track, I think it's a quarter mile walking track around the playground, so the kids have something to do when our playground's all wet and mushy. And so it's been a great thing for our community and our school. Another thing we've been able to do is, between the last school year and this school year, we were able to donate money to buy iPad carts, so that each classroom would have their own iPad cart to charge and to store their iPads. So that was a great thing. The second thing I really wanted to be able to do was to help the kids have a lot of fun, because I think that school should be fun, and I think when the kids are having fun and they're enjoying it, they can learn better. That's been my experience. So we do a lot of support with parties, for Halloween and Christmas and different holidays. And this Halloween, we had a lot of parents come into the school and help do some different games, and we had some treats, and we did the thriller dance, and the kids had a lot of fun. So that was a really good thing for us. And the final thing I feel like PTO should do is link parents to the school to give them an opportunity to know what's going on and give teachers a chance to have parents coming in and help. And so at our back-to-school night this year, I set up right by that front door with some treats, and I pestered every parent that came through and said, sign up for PTO, you can have a treat. And so we got a lot more parents involved this year. As you can see, that this may not look like a lot, but this is probably triple what our PTO meetings used to be. And so we've got a lot more parents coming, they're involved, they're helping with our activities and our fundraisers. Our book fair was incredible. We had a lot of parents help, and we decided Scholastic gave us extra money back for pushing our book fair back. And so we did it over the Thanksgiving feast, that final week before Thanksgiving. And we were able to raise $1,400 in books for our teachers, which is incredible. So just, I think on the day of the Thanksgiving feast, we had the book fair open, and you saw we had so many people there. I think we sold over $2,000 one day alone, just that 1 hour, that lunch hour. So we have great parents, and they do a lot to help the kids, and I feel really lucky and blessed to be a part of it. We have great teachers and great staff teaching our kids, so thank you.
So in summary, I hope that you're realizing that maybe the Grinch wasn't so bad. His heart grew, and he became mighty because he learned from others. And so we want to just say thank you. This community that supports us, our hearts are always growing in multiple ways, and we are learning that we are so much better together. Strong as 10 Grinches plus 2. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts.
Thank you. Are there any questions for the school? Lloyd?
All right, I don't want anyone to take this the wrong way, so I'll give you an opportunity to sell this. So we've recently voted to extend our one-to-one initiative throughout the district with a plan. One of the very genuine and valid concerns that was brought up was, are we becoming a smarter district because of this educational tool, or are we just making it more fun? I know we're building confidence, and some social skills are going along with this, but I guess, Mr. Werner, you're probably going to be the best one to answer this, and you may slide this question over to one of your students, but what can you tell us that would give us the confidence to know that that was money well spent?
Well, my question would be, how do you make a classroom more engaging? It is very heartening when you have students sitting in your classroom and they're bored. You know, we talked about making it more entertaining. And the question is how do you get them to be more involved with what you're trying to sell? Because basically, all teachers are business people trying to sell an education to the students to better our community. So I would say it's a great investment. And you know, if you want to be one of the districts that's competing with districts around us, you got to find a way to raise the scores. And the iPad is a great tool. You have students that get done early with their assignments. I mean, how do you differentiate from them? Especially with the technology that's expected in the workplace for the next 10 or 15 years, how do you prepare them for that? Most of those jobs aren't even here yet.
So the engagement piece is a valid, and I completely can stand behind that. So what you're saying is because of the increase in engagement as well as the other tools that we mentioned or skills, the social skills, the confidence that they get, do you feel that the scores are going to start showing that in the near future, or do you feel like this is just more of an alternate teaching method, or do you feel like we're going to go the next level up with actual data that says that our kids are learning more?
I think you're going to have great data. I mean, just if you look at the way administrators go around and do their walkthroughs, I mean, the way that they collect data is changing as well. Tours will show that, but just talking to the children and seeing how interested they are in the subjects that they're in, I think that's really a great way. You know, all of the students that came here tonight, I mean, they volunteered as soon as they found out that this was an option to be able to stand up and talk in front of adults, not their peers, but adults that they look up to. I mean, that, I think right there, I mean, that's a great vision as well.
And I think, and thanks for your answer. And I, and just a second, Laura, I can completely get behind the fact that we're educating more well-rounded, better students with better life skills. I think it's great. The confidence you see in students that have had a technology tool in their hand is amazing. Just the, how well-spoken they are, how they want to come and engage us. Those kind of things I think are great, but I want to be able to put, to really, to defend this to the community when we just said, hey, we're going to spend a lot of money on this. I think Dana was the one that brought up that concern in a very valid way. Are we getting the value from that investment?
As a teacher, I'd rather work for a proactive district instead of a reactive district, and I think the investment that the school board has decided to make into this program, I think it's going to be very proactive.
Great. Thank you for your answer.
What I was going to say is Jean and I at KASB this weekend had a really, really good, and it didn't deal with technology per se. It was, the speaker spoke about the different generations. And so during open discussion, I think I might want to hit on some of the points that he made that I think are going to go to some of the things that you're saying or asking. And give us a way to maybe explain why we're doing what we're doing technologically as well.
Just, I'd like to throw this out to one of the kids, if you feel so inclined to answer. If not, it's not a big deal, but do you feel like this, your iPads are making you more intelligent? Do you feel like you're getting better at math and better at things, or are you just having a lot of fun? That's a fair question. I mean, and I want you to be completely honest.
Well, I feel like when we're on the iPads, we're like engaged, and I feel like it helps our learning more. I mean, because the teachers are watching us, and like Mr. Horney, on his iPad, he can see whatever we're doing. And he actually said, like, he can see if we're on a different app and if we're playing a game. So he knows if we're like messing around, and he knows if we're really doing Shelby and doing our work. And they can check on our work whenever they want, and they can like see if we're just playing around on the iPad or, you know, just doodling. So I feel
great.
Like,
thank you for your answer. The other thing that you mentioned is you get instant feedback, which is really good for learning. If you know right away you're doing something wrong, Mr. Horney can interrupt and say, oh, you're missing this one step that we taught. So I think that instant feedback is a huge asset, and I think that will lead into your skill sets and your accomplishments in the classroom going up. So thank you for having the courage to speak. I appreciate that.
Probably, as a parent, I really like the iPads and open communication. I've got four kids and I work, and to be honest, I don't look through the backpacks overnight, but when I've got the app on my phone and Ms. Horney's, you know, they submit certain things, I see more than I ever did before.
Right.
What they're actually doing, what they're working on, and, you know, I've got kids, they come home, you know, they don't want to work on homework, but when they come home, Mom, can I get on the app? I want to do this and I want to do that, on math or whatever, they're really engaged. And it's making a difference as far as I'm concerned.
Great. Well, that's a very most important thing is to hear that from a parent. So I think the more we do this, I think the data is just going to take care of itself, and the scores are just going to go through the roof is what it sounds like. So I hope no one took that as I was leading it down a wrong path.